Dear students, I am Shiva, faculty of physics. I hope you are doing well in your studies with these bricks. In this episode, we are going to discuss one important topic for 8th standard students, that is Karpat dipole. So in order to understand this topic properly, we can concentrate on some prerequisites that are important for this topic. So first prerequisite here, Newton's first law. So here, Newton's first law gives some information for us what happens to the object if F external is equal to 0. So here, this Newton's first law, we can divide into two parts. One we can concentrate on rest state, another one we can concentrate on motion state. Means in the rest state as well as in motion state, what happens to the object if F external is equal to 0. So first of all, we can concentrate on rest part of the object. So here we are seeing one object. This object now initially we are seeing in the state of rest. So nothing but this object experiences two forces now. So one force is exerted by earth. Okay. Why this force exerted by earth? Earth exerted this force because of the Newton's third law. Another force now exerted by earth only, but that force exerted by earth on this block due to the field created by it. Okay, in this situation you are seeing now these L and Mg balances with each other. Why? I am saying the state of the object is rest. Suppose if Mg you are thinking more than L, then this block has a chance to enter deep into that. That one not happens here. Otherwise, if you are thinking N is more than Mg, this block now moves into the A. That situation also not happened here. Why? I am saying clearly the state of the object is rest. Nothing but the normal force balances with gravitational force. Now in this situation, then what we can say? N is equal to Mg. Okay, this is the situation for this block. We are seeing at what time? At the instant 0 second. Okay. Again, we can see the instant at t seconds. Okay, at t seconds also still I am saying the block now in the state of rest. Nothing but still the block experiences two forces as that of here. One is normal force, another one gravitational force. So in this case also N clearly equal to Mg. So that's why the object now maintains the state of rest even when the time changes from 0 to t seconds. Finally, here what we can conclude, whenever you are seeing the object that is in the state of rest, the object continues the state of rest until the F external acting on the object is 0. So that's why this object now continuing the state of rest. Now we can concentrate on motion part of the object. What happens to the object in motion when F external is equal to 0? In order to understand this situation, we can consider one example where the acceleration acting on the object, suppose I am taking here 2 m/s². Okay. So again, we are concentrating on one ball-like object. Okay. So that ball, assuming itself, it is moving on the smooth surface. This is the surface that we are assuming, suppose smooth, nothing but no frictional force. Now, due to the some external force, this velocity of the ball now continuously increasing according to this acceleration. Nothing but here acceleration I am saying 2 m/s². For each second, velocity of the object there increases by what value? 2 m/s. So first of all, at t is equal to 0 seconds, I am assuming the velocity now 0 m/s, that is initial velocity. At the time t is equal to 1 second, the velocity of the object now here 2 m/s. Okay. So again at the time t is equal to 2 seconds, the velocity of the object now here 4 m/s. Okay. So for each second, so 0 to 1 it is increased by 2 m/s, 1 to 2 seconds also it is increased by 4 m/s. For each second, the velocity of the object now increased by that value 2 meter per second because of the acceleration 2 meter per second square. Suppose you are taking the external force acting on this object is equal to 0 at what time? At second. Okay? From that instant onwards, that object's motion turns to uniformly accelerated motion to uniform motion. Uniformly accelerated motion to uniform motion. What do you mean by uniform motion? Uniform motion is nothing but the motion where the velocity of the object is constant in both magnitude and direction. So velocity is constant in both magnitude and direction for what type of motion? That motion only we can say with what name? Uniform motion. That's why this uniform accelerated motion now turns into from second onwards into what type of motion? Uniform motion. Okay? So here we are concentrating this ball again. So after third second, still no change in velocity with respect to both magnitude and direction. Its value still 4 meter per second. Here nature of the surface also same again. Okay? So again, even you are concentrating on this ball at 4th second, still that's value 4 meter per second. And again, even you are concentrating on this same ball at 5th second, still that value of velocity is 4 meter per second. Nothing but clearly we are seeing this accelerated motion over the time period 0 to 2 seconds, that is accelerated motion. From 2 seconds to 5 seconds in that period, you are seeing that accelerated motion turning into uniform motion. Okay? Why? Because of the net external force acting on the object is 0 at second. Okay, let us observe the situation happens for uniformly decelerated motion or not. Suppose we are taking one more example that explains what happens to the decelerated motion of the object when F external is equal to 0. Suppose we can assume the deceleration of the object here minus 2 meter per second square. Okay? And we are concentrating on the object like a ball only. But instead of having 0 velocity at 0 second, assume its velocity, suppose I am taking 8 meter per second, initial velocity. Okay? Initial velocity for that ball is what? 8 meter per second. Assume now this surface is smooth. Okay? Except the force that causes this acceleration only acting here, there is no other force further. Okay, initially this velocity now 8 meter per second. Again, we are concentrating on this ball at first second. At this first second also, since deceleration is 2 meter per second square, its velocity is decreased by what value? 2 meter per second. Again this value will become 6 meter per second. Okay? Again I am concentrating on this bar. At the time second, again this value of 6 meter per second reduced by 2 meter per second, it will become again 4 meter per second. Suppose you can assume, suppose it happens or assume at time t is equal to 2 seconds, the net external force acting on the object is 0. From that instant onwards, the uniformly decelerated motion converts into uniform motion. Okay? Nothing but you can concentrate on the motion of the object further. This is again one plane path. Okay? We are concentrating on this ball only. From the situation second onwards, this is third second. At third second also, what is the value of velocity? Still 4 meter per second only. At fourth second, what is the value of this velocity? Still 4 meter per second only. At 5th second, what is the value of velocity? No change, still 4 meter per second. Okay? Nothing but from 0 to second, what type of motion it is? it is uniformly decelerated motion. From second to fifth second, what type of motion it is? It is uniform motion, nothing but the uniformly decelerated motion converts into uniform motion from the instant onwards when the net external force acting on the object is zero. So from these examples, clearly what we can conclude about Newton's first law? The object in the state of rest continues in the state of rest if F external over the period is zero. The object is already in accelerated motion or decelerated motion, converts into uniform motion from the instant when F external is equal to zero. So this is regarding to the information about the first prerequisite. Now second prerequisite that we can concentrate here, torque. So what do you mean by torque? Torque is a physical quantity that is responsible for rotational motion of the object. So here we are concentrating one object. Okay, so here I put some black dot. So this one, assume now one particle. For this particle, their mass m. We are denoting this particle's position vector with respect to the origin. So say this is r bar. Okay, the angle between r bar and this horizontal axis is theta. Okay, this object we are seeing in the xy plane, and the force acting on the object now you are seeing in the rightward direction. If this angle is theta, so what about this angle? This angle also theta over there. Okay, so now how can we define the expression for the torque here? So we can define the expression for the torque in this manner. Tau bar is equal to r bar cross f bar. R bar is the position vector of the particle with respect to the origin. F bar is the force acting on the object. Okay, so if you want to express this vector in magnitude form, nothing but with the help of unit vector notation, we can write it rf sine theta into n hat. Okay, so r indicates the magnitude of the position vector r bar, f indicates the magnitude of the applied force f bar, theta indicates the angle between r bar and f bar, n hat indicates the unit vector in the direction that is perpendicular to the plane containing this r bar and f bar. So actually here now r bar and f bar you are seeing in the xy plane. This unit vector now lies where? This unit vector lies in the plane that is perpendicular to xy. Perpendicular to xy means outward direction. Maybe that vector lies either in plus z direction or minus z direction, but it is not mandatory. It depends upon the plane over which this r bar and f bar vectors are lying. But in our case, it may be definitely lies either in plus z direction or minus z direction. Okay. Now I am writing this expression in fully magnitude form. In scalar form, how can we write down this expression? Tau is equal to rf sine theta. Okay. So again here we can write down this expression as tau is equal to r sine theta into f. So what do you mean by r sine theta? This r sine theta now we can put with that symbol r perpendicular. This r perpendicular indicates perpendicular distance along the line of action of the force F bar from the axis of rotation. So what do you mean by r perpendicular? R perpendicular we can say with that name moment arm. Moment arm nothing but the perpendicular distance on the line of action of the force F bar from the axis of rotation. Suppose let us concentrate on this r perpendicular, how we can recognize it in this diagram. So this is F bar force. If you draw this is line of action. Okay, so along this line of action, this is r bar, this R bar now you can take components. One component here we can see as R cos theta. Another component we can see in this direction. This is what value? This is R sin theta. So R sin theta perpendicular to the line of action of the force F bar. This is R sin theta. This R sin theta clearly perpendicular to the line of action of F bar. This one only here I am denoted with that symbol R perpendicular. Okay. This R perpendicular gives for us perpendicular distance along the line of action of the force. This is axis of rotation. What is this one? This is axis of rotation. Okay. Now observe the same expression. We can write this expression again. R into F sin theta. R into F sin theta. This one again we can write as R into Ft. What is Ft? Ft nothing but tangential component of the force that is responsible for the rotatory motion. Tangential component means the component of the force that is perpendicular to the R bar. The tangential component of the force nothing but the component of force that is perpendicular to the R bar. That force only, that component only causes what type of motion here? Rotational motion. Now observe here. This is force F bar. You can resolve this force. One component of the force you can see in this direction. This is F cos theta. F cos theta you are seeing in the direction of R bar. So see, this is the direction of the R bar as well as this is the direction of F cos theta. Now it causes any rotational motion? No. Why? You are clearly seeing this one acting in the direction like this. Maybe if happens, any motion there happens, it will cause what type of motion? Translatory motion. There is no transfer. Rotatory motion. Suppose if you are taking its tangential component, nothing but the component of the force that is perpendicular to the R bar. So what is the component of the force here perpendicular to R bar? You are seeing like this. This is F sin theta. Okay. So F sin theta clearly perpendicular to R bar. This F sin theta, now you are seeing it causes what type of motion? Rotatory motion. So that's why this F sin theta only we are labeled with this term Ft. Now we can try to understand this explanation with the help of the door. Okay, see now, observe. A little bit carefully. So in this situation, okay, this is some, here I am showing the R bar. R bar what? R bar is the position vector. That position vector indicates what? Application, point of application of the force. Okay, so this is the force we are applying in this direction. This is R bar. Okay, in this situation, this R bar now we are denoting from this rotational axis. Again here, if this R bar component you are taking in this direction, now from this onwards here we are dropping one line of action. So on this line of action, we are drawing this perpendicular component of this R bar. It causes for what type of motion? Rotatory motion. Now this is F, this is what for us? R sin theta. This F, this R sin theta only responsible for what type of motion? Rotatory motion. Nothing but whenever you can apply the force in this direction, okay, at that time only you can see either clockwise rotation or anti-clockwise rotation. Suppose you are applying the force in the direction of this R bar, there is no chance for the rotatory motion. Okay. Now this is the concept of second prerequisite labeled as torque. Now let us concentrate on the third prerequisite. So here we have labeled this third prerequisite with the name types of equilibrium. Types of equilibrium. So what do you mean by the types of equilibrium? So here the types of equilibrium we can divide under two ideas. One is based upon force, another one based upon the equilibrium. Okay. So based upon the force here what we can say? So based upon the force, suppose you are seeing f external is equal to 0. At that time, the object now we can say either in the state of rest or in the state of uniform motion. At that time, that type of equilibrium we can say with that name, translational equilibrium. Okay, translational equilibrium nothing but the net external force acting on the object is 0 and the object now either in the state of rest or in the state of uniform motion. Again, if you are concentrating rotational equilibrium, okay, this is what type of equilibrium now? Translational equilibrium. Okay, now we are concentrating there, net external torque is 0. Okay, at that time still the object is in the state of rest or it was in motion with uniform angular velocity. At that time the state we can say with the name rotational equilibrium. Rotational equilibrium. Okay, so these are the two types of equilibrium that we can say based upon the force. Next, that equilibrium again we can divide based upon the amount of potential energy it will contain by itself. Suppose we are seeing one case here. What is that case? So assume one vessel. Okay, this is some vessel. In this vessel we are keeping some ball. Okay, this is U-shaped vessel. In this U-shaped vessel we are keeping some ball here. You can displace the ball in either direction. Suppose I am displacing the ball in this direction. Now what will happen? That ball still comes to its original position. This is the original position. Now even you can shift a little bit either leftward or rightward, the ball still comes to its original location. Nothing but at that time, then what will happen? Potential energy of the object is always tends to minimum. Nothing but in this situation, u value is minimum. So whenever the u value is minimum, that type of equilibrium we can say with that name stable equilibrium. Stable equilibrium. Nothing but what do you mean by stable equilibrium? Stable equilibrium is the situation where the potential energy of the object is minimum and you can displace the object once either in leftward or rightward direction. That object now tries to regain its original position. Okay, now in this situation what will happen? Suppose I am taking u is the function of x. U is the function of x. I am saying here u is minimum. According to the extreme rules of calculus, here what we can write? Du by dx is equal to 0 and d square u by dx square is u minimum. U minimum means it will become greater than 0. Okay. So now come to one more case of equilibrium. So instead of this one, assume now this is one more U-shaped vessel. Over that U-shaped vessel you are keeping one ball-like object. Now you are displacing the ball either in this direction or in this direction. What will happen? Does the ball come back to its original position? No. The ball never come back to its original position. Why? Why means every object in the universe always tries to regain its potential energy as far as possible minimum. That's why once you can displace the ball, it will maintain the minimum potential energy. That's why here, for this ball, there is no chance to come back. But initially, before disturbing this ball, what is the value for you? The value for you in this case maximum, in this case minimum. Okay? This is stable equilibrium. Now, in this case, you are seeing maximum. That's why here u value maximum. And this type of situation we can say with the name unstable equilibrium. Okay, so in unstable equilibrium, object always tries to maintain maximum potential energy. And once you can disturb the object, that object can't be able to regain its original position. Now for u is equal to maximum, suppose u is equal to, we are saying as function of x. What is the equation here? We can write du by dx is equal to 0 and d square u by dx square is less than 0. Okay. Now let us come to the last case of this equilibrium. Suppose you are seeing one smooth surface. On that smooth surface, this ball is in motion. Okay. So this is some ball. This ball is in motion. Assume now this ball is in motion. Suppose either this motion, what type of motion, there is no problem. Either accelerated, decelerated, uniform. Okay, what type of motion is no problem. But assume the ball now that just moving on the plane surface. Okay, whatever may be that state, either accelerated, decelerated, or uniform. Now in this situation, there what we can see. Suppose here this object, this ball center. In our case, this object is ball. Now, this ball center always we are seeing at what height? Always we are seeing at the same height. Okay. Always we are seeing at the same height means what about the potential energy? Potential energy of the ball is always minimum. Nothing but there is no change in the potential energy of the ball. Nothing but u is equal to constant. U is equal to constant. Whenever u is equal to constant, at that time what we can say, du by dx is equal to 0 as well as d square u by dx square is equal to 0. So these are the types of equilibrium that we are defined and based upon force and as well as based upon the potential energy regarding to that equilibrium. Okay students, in this session we covered some prerequisites that are helpful in order to understand the topic Torque Dipole. So first prerequisite, we studied about Newton's first law. It gives some information for us. What happens to the object if F net is equal to 0 when the object is in the state of rest, accelerated motion as well as decelerated motion. Thereafter we studied about torque. So torque causes rotating motion, and this torque in vector form we can represent like this, r bar cross f bar, and in scalar form we can represent r perpendicular into f, r into tangential component of force. Later we studied about types of equilibrium. First two types, translational, rotational, we are giving this category based upon the force. Next three types we are dividing based upon the potential energy, stable, unstable, neutral, and the equations corresponding to this potential energy. I hope you understood this lecture well. In the next session we will continue this episode as part 2. So thank you for watching.